Coke,
crack,
coke,
crack,
coke,
crack,
coke,
crack,
coke.
Once upon a time, I knew what it was like to be happy.
Coke,
crack,
coke,
crack.
Then something soured.
Crack,
coke.
I became a moody adolescent. An anxious teenager. And in college, I fell into a depression and was prescribed Zoloft, my first SSRI. Over the years, I've also experimented with other substances to varying degrees of success. Caffeine makes me, alcohol makes me. Here's some pictures from a mushroom trip I took in Cadaqués, Spain. For almost half my life, I've been on some kind of drug that is supposed to make me feel better. And I'm not the only one. What is the nature of the happiness we're seeking? And which drugs get us there the fastest? A lot of the science around happiness is pretty soft. But Axel Bouchon's expertise is locating and measuring the chemicals responsible for positive emotions. This is how he explains it.
We have six neurotransmitters that give us all our positive emotions. Dopamine, testosterone, serotonin, oxytocin, cannabinoids, and opioids. So every emotion we can consciously experience is a combination of these six molecules. But humans are very creative. They said, hey, how can I fill very quickly, up to the maximum, these cups?
Drugs.
Dopamine, all the drugs are all stimulants. Cocaine, Adderall, caffeine. Everything what is kind of stimulating you to get motivated is nothing else than a shortcut for dopamine. Next one is testosterone. Testosterone in various formats. Come to serotonin. What is ecstasy on the illegal side, but Prozac and all the other antidepressants on the legal side. Then you have cannabinoids. The name already tells you this is marijuana, weed. And then we have opioids, heroin. Then comes oxytocin, and there's none. The event of giving birth is so strong that there is no drug out there that can compete. Or even go one step further and say social media, a drug as well, because it's a behavioral drug. It is the excitement that you get an immediate response. That's a classical little dopamine hit, excitement. The second thing you get is you get likes, superb recognition. Ultimately, you are looking for friendship, you're looking for cannabinoids, but you're getting a little bit of dopamine and serotonin. That's why you're kind of continuing to spend time, but it's only giving more serotonin, but still no cannabinoids.
I've done drugs, done a lot of them, over a lot of long time. Sounds like I've done drugs with that sentence.
This is Ben Goldhirsch, Axel's business partner.
The way Prozac works, you've got serotonin that's released by one neuron. It floats around in your brain, in the synapse, in the space between the neurons, and then it gets sucked up by this neuron.
Not that I don't trust Ben, but we decided to bring in our own neuroscientists to explain how drugs work in the brain. This is Dr. Esther Odekunle. She has a PhD in neurobiology and enjoys explaining neuroscience-y things to the internet.
And I heard you guys need some help.
Yep.
Okay. So the way Prozac and other SSRIs actually work is by binding to and blocking serotonin transporters, which are proteins that recycle neurotransmitters from the synapse back into the neurons they were released from. This means that more serotonin is available in the synaptic space to transmit those feel-good signals to other neurons.
Whoops.
Which is why SSRIs are commonly used to treat depression. Cocaine functions by blocking the reuptake of the neurotransmitters serotonin, norepinephrine, and dopamine, resulting in a buildup of these neurotransmitters in the synapse. The longer they stay in the synapse, the longer they can transmit signals that contribute to improved mood and a feeling of increased performance. Now, MDMA and cocaine increase levels of the same neurotransmitters, so you might be wondering, why do they have different effects? Well, MDMA releases much more serotonin than cocaine. And the areas of the brain altered by MDMA and cocaine are different. Cannabis contains active ingredients called cannabinoids. These cannabinoids have a similar structure to neurotransmitters called endocannabinoids. And so cannabis mimics their effects by binding to all cannabinoid receptors. The overstimulation of the cannabinoid receptors leads to a general feeling of euphoria, relaxation, as well as heightened or altered sensory and time perception. Opioids like heroin or OxyContin infuse the synapse with active chemicals which mimic endorphins that naturally bind to our opioid receptors. When opioid receptors are activated, they can reduce the release of molecules that signal pain and can regulate functions like hormone release and general feelings of well-being. Activation of certain opioid receptors suppress the release of the alert neurotransmitter norepinephrine. When opioids are not present anymore, for example, when someone stops taking heroin, these previously suppressed neurons become very active, releasing excessive amounts of norepinephrine, which triggers symptoms characteristic of withdrawal, such as jitters, anxiety, muscle cramps, and diarrhea. I think you guys can take it from here.
Okay, so why can't you just take all these drugs at once and fill up all our cups at the same time?
So the challenge with drugs is you can only fill one cup with one drug. That's number one. Number two is when you fill a cup very quickly, the cup becomes more and more difficult to be filled as you go along. That's kind of dependency and addiction. And the last thing, the idea was that the brain learns what you do in order to become more happy. However, with drugs, you learn to take something.
I knew that I wasn't stoked about work, so I take Adderall. And the fascinating thing about Adderall is, like, rather than doing work that inspires you, you just take a pill and you're inspired and then you do work. Like, how do you even know if you like what you're doing? Literally, you take a pill and then someone could talk to you about, you know, window frames. You're like, this is fucking fascinating. Let's get into window framing. It is like the Cupid's arrow of inspiration.
You can even imagine that your brain is guiding you towards the cup that is most empty for you. So in other words, if you miss friendship love, you may tend to smoke weed. If you're kind of just missing excitement and motivation and where to go, you normally have this with people using Adderall or cocaine. In essence, we find the deficiencies that we actually have reflected in a way on the type of drugs we use.
According to Axel's schematic, what I'm really craving is friendship, because of the weed, and recognition from the serotonin. What do your respective vices say about you and what you're really searching for?
Now, if you look on the six neurotransmitters, it's very interesting that actually 2 to 3 of them you can trigger by yourself. This is mainly the dopamine motivation thing and the serotonin piece. But the youngest one, cannabinoids, opioids, oxytocin, is actually only be able to be triggered by others. In that context, events that you memorize for yourself are normally not your biggest events. It's normally together with a lot of people in a really good mood and a lot of laughter. These are the magic moments, if you will. You have a dinner with friends that triggers, on the one hand, amusement because you laugh. That is dopamine, cannabinoids, and a little bit of opioids. Then you have on top of that, an interesting conversation, what is in that context kind of just giving yourself recognition because you're allowed to tell something what makes you feel great. So you have serotonin on top. Now let's just assume you are single and there are a lot of potential partners, so you get at least a little bit of testosterone. The brain actually loves also kind of just pretty high and stable levels over a longer period of time. So that means a beautiful week with some contentment is actually a very, very strong positive signal for our brain. So therefore you can choose, how do I organize my events in my life to get as many as often as possibly filled?
Maybe this is why happiness is hard. There are all these things you have to do for yourself, but no one thing you're doing is actually going to make you happy, including taking a pill or doing a drug. For example, even if I took an SSRI every day for the rest of my life, I still wouldn't be in balance and would have four other cups I'd need to fill somehow.
Given that the brain craves for these neurotransmitters and ultimately the organism for happiness, that's the guiding principle. Listen to the brain because it actually tells you exactly where to go.
When it comes to happiness, there may be no magic potion. Instead, it might be as simple as doing something fun with someone you love. Thank you.